know, my family, like many of our stories, of my parents divorced when I was a baby. And the pain, and I lived with my mother, and the pain of not having a stable biological father was something that really bled into all the other areas of my life. And it was something that I could tell you to your face, it sucks, it hurts, it's painful, but I'm fine, it's no big deal. We all have worse stories. There's somebody else with a worse background than I have. But just because there's somebody out there with a tougher experience or a harder experience doesn't make my experience any less significant to me and my pain any less. So in 2016, the first time that I was asked to take this inventory, I looked at fun and recreation. Well, yeah, I know how to do that. I know how to work hard in business. I know how to pour back into a community. When I looked at that relationship with my family life, my first goal in 2016 was really to pour into my relationship with my stepfather. So I was fortunate enough to have my stepfather enter my life at a really young age. The type of person that he is he's where I'm still waters run deep, he's even stiller waters run deeper. And my whole life he had been there for me, but in a very I've struggled to use the word hands off. It wasn't hands off. It was, I'd say, more quietly, patiently waiting. And in 2016, when I first began to take inventory of this, I realized that, you know, I have a responsibility in this relationship too. So my first goal was, I didn't even realize that the father piece would play a piece or part into this, but my first goal was really in 2016 to spend time with Pete. So the first year was doing those sort of things, planning trips, talking on the phone, going to baseball games. I even, towards the end of 2016, I actually, what spurred all of this is I took my whole family, plus Pete's dearest childhood friends and my mother's childhood friends, and we all rented a cabin in Blue Ridge. And so that was towards the fall, winter of 2016. So then we entered my second year of doing personal and professional best. And I again made it a priority to really spend time with Pete and get to know him, because I was so caught up in the pain of being rejected by a biological father. I never spent time getting to know somebody who had really been there my whole life. So when I started to put my attention on my relationship with Pete, that really started to blossom. The beautiful part in all of this and really figuring out what I wanted to do, I actually asked Pete to adopt me. And that was really awesome for both of us. I still remember vividly having a conversation with Pete. And he had waited my whole life, you know, for me to acknowledge him that and didn't want to force himself on me. And it was incredibly healing for me, for Pete, for my mom, for Pete's family, who are my grandparents and who I've never known not to be my family. But just to have that formal recognition about it, you know, I'm an adult, and technically I guess you don't have to go through all this process of formalizing that sort of stuff, but for me it was so healing to actually acknowledge somebody who had been my dad my whole life. I'm forever grateful to the Personal Professional Best program for putting me in a position to really take a moment to analyze all these buckets and areas of my life.
Hey Nancy, thank you so much for having the courage to create your story and for having the courage to share your story with all of us today. Relationships are the most important part of our lives, and succeeding in relationships at home with family and friends and in the workplace with colleagues and customers is the key to unlocking your best life. It's the key to writing your best life story. I'm Pat Flood, and on behalf of Supreme Lending, I welcome all of you to our program, Becoming Our Personal and Professional Best. The Personal and Professional Best program was established 4 years ago for the Supreme Associate population with a simple inspiration: to enroll, to encourage, to educate, and to serve as an accountability partner for all of the Supreme Associates so they would pursue their best and become their best. Over the last 4 years since establishing PNPB, we've experienced story after story of lives changing for the better. With this in mind, we decided to offer our program to another key constituent who helps us build our business every day: you, our realtor partners. So today, we welcome our Supreme Southeast Associates, friends and family, and we offer a special welcome to our many realtor partners from South Florida to Central Florida, Atlanta to Charlotte, North Carolina. Today, our personal and professional best focus is on relationships, with a specific interest to offer insights on two areas. Number one, what are the key ingredients that help build the best long-term relationships in life, at home and in the workplace? And number two, how do we mend relationships that have been broken? Because we all have them. If we're successful today, we can get closer to our goal of writing our best life stories, and that will make the world a better place. With this inspiration in mind, we invited one of the top leadership voices of our generation to share his insights and his wisdom on today's topic. Our guest speaker today is a master communicator. He's the best-selling author of 20 books and pastor of one of America's biggest churches. His weekly messages, leadership videos, podcast, and TV program are downloaded and viewed by over 7 million people a month. Simply said, he's an expert at influencing people to become their best, which is why he's a great fit for our program today. Andy Stanley, welcome to Personal and Professional Best.
Thanks for having me, Pat.
Yep. Andy, before we get started with today's content, I wanted to personally thank you on behalf of the Flood family, Pat and Lisa, TJ and Kenzie, and on behalf of the many, many others that are watching today and otherwise, where your coaching and your counsel has benefited and changed their lives. So thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Absolutely. And your audience should know that you and I have been friends for a long time. So this is a lot of fun. Thanks.
Appreciate it. Yep. Andy, today's all about relationships, and we have a very diverse crowd with us. Many know you by either attending church, watching you on video or TV, or by reading your books. Others that are here today are not churchgoers, and frankly, they don't know very much about you. They're meeting you today for the very first time. So because we're hosting a diverse audience, I thought we'd get started with me asking you some questions so our audience might get to know you better.
Okay.
You okay with that?
Assuming there's that much interest on the part of your audience.
We'll go right ahead. I think there's lots of interest, Andy, right? So the questions are going to be from the six categories that make up our Personal Professional Best program. So most of us know, reading your bio, even those who've never gone to your church, that you now have shared with us that you've been married to Sandra for 30 years, three grown children. Congratulations, by the way. You just had an anniversary.
Yeah, 30th, yeah.
That's pretty darn good. Listen, and I know, like you, I've been married 34 years. Lisa and I just had an anniversary as well that I have and have had a much better and richer life because Lisa's been in it. So, you know, you and I have been incredibly blessed guys. So tell us, Andy, when you get together now, Sandra, three grown children, like where's that place and time during the year where like the most special Stanley family happening takes place?
Yeah, and you know, different seasons of life, it changes. And so from the very beginning, we've had an enormous family gathering vacation with Sandra's family. It's about 20, 22 people at Hilton Head for a week every year. We haven't missed it. We've done 26 years.
Wow.
26 years in a row. This gathering at Hilton Head, South Carolina, with her parents just rent a big house. And we're very fortunate that that many people get along and can get along for a week. And Sandra's parents joke all the time. They say, you know, our friends try this and it's a disaster. No, you know, you can have this part of the family for half the week and then that brother-in-law who doesn't get along with. So we're super blessed, and we can talk about this a little bit later. But seeing that in her family really helped me determine the North Star for our family and our family dynamic. But that's our big thing. But when the kids were younger, you know, more in the rhythm of life, it was dinner time. Dinner time was always a strategic part of both parenting, staying connected with our kids. So I'd say from dinner to Hilton Head, those are the the most influential family environments.
Wow, when you're trying to build a family these days with the busyness of kids and and two people working, it's really difficult. You got to make it important, though, right?
And you got to build it into the rhythm, into the schedule. It does not happen automatically. And what happens is everything else in life is intentional. I know when I have to be at work. I know when I have to be at school. And so family just kind of gets shuffled around. And yet at the end of the day, as everybody knows, family is what makes us who we are. So why would we not be as intentional with scheduling family as we are with the other schedules in life?
Wow. Yep. So here we are in the now, 30 years married, grown children, right? Author, pastor, we know what you do for a living. Let's go back a bit, okay, early on and see if we can learn some things about you that we don't know. All right. Born in Atlanta?
Born in North Carolina.
Wow.
Yeah.
That would surprise, I think, a lot of people.
Yeah, what would really surprise you is my dad was a pastor. I'm a preacher's kid. And he was pastoring a church about the size of this room in Fruitland, North Carolina. And fortunately for me, there wasn't a hospital in Fruitland, or I would have been born in Fruitland, North Carolina. But we went to the big city of Hendersonville, North Carolina, and that's where I was actually born.
Gotcha. So, wow. Anyway, so Henderson's now famous,
Hendersonville,
right?
Yeah,
absolutely. Only child?
Sister, three years younger.
Cool. All right, so here we go. Early in childhood, let's say first grade, you're out on the playground. Are you playing or are you like on a picnic table or on a hill speaking into the lives,
pretty much,
your other first graders?
Yes, pretty much on the picnic table speaking truth into the lives of the, no, absolutely not. I had a very, very normal childhood thanks to my parents.
I say that because, you know, people imagine that your life was different than most of theirs growing up,
very,
right?
Very normal.
All right. So so everyone knows you've written 20 books now, right? You've done amazing things with the church in terms of business growth and everything else. Did you ever get a B in school?
Actually, I was not a great student. I'm a little bit ADD, not extreme. My big academic moment, and this is not an exaggeration, it sounds like a story. I started at Georgia State University. I graduated from Georgia State University. I was there the whole time. I was a journalism major. My first semester, I was on academic warning. And then my second semester, academic probation. So I was living at home with my family, going to school real cheap. And my mom sat me down at the kitchen table. I can still picture where we were, the color of the kitchen. And she started talking to me about school. And I thought she was going to give me a pep talk. Like, you can do this. You just need to, you know, spend more time. And she looked at me and she paused and she said, Andy, college isn't for everyone. So I'm expecting a pep talk. She's kind of letting me down. You know what? You're probably not going to make it in college, but that's okay, son. College isn't for everyone. It scared me to death. So I immediately buckled down and started studying and did pretty well after those first two semesters. So no pep talk. College is not for everyone, son. Can you believe that?
Well, I'll tell you what, you know, it should be encouraging to all of us because what you really did was you found your gift, right? So school's not for everyone.
Yeah, but then in graduate school, I excelled and I loved school. I just didn't like studying things that I wasn't interested
in.
All
right, so let's move on to health and fitness. You can tell that you take good care of yourself, right?
Because
we've talked about this in the past. How do you do it?
Yeah, well, nobody has time to exercise. You have to begin with that. And so you just have to figure out in the rhythm of life how to make it a priority. So through the years, like most people, I've done different things. I ran for a long time. I had a couple of minor back surgeries. So the end of running. My wife and I, Sandra, were empty nesters. So again, what we can do now in that regard, we could not have done when we were raising kids and getting kids up early in the morning. So we work out two or three times a week together with a trainer, which is amazing. And as a couple, it's something that we don't look forward to, but that we actually, when one doesn't want to go, the other one goes, that we do together. So that's a lot of fun. But I've always had whether it's college, graduate school, early married, you just find a way to make it a priority because, when you invest in your health, you're really investing in yourself and you're investing in your future relationships. And specifically, as you get to our season of life, you're investing in your relationships with your grandkids. I don't have any grandkids, but I want to be active. I don't want to be the grandfather who the grandkids have to help get up out of the chair and you can't get on the floor and play and all those things. And you don't think about that in your 30s and 40s, but you reap what you sow. And if you're not sowing into your health, you're going to reap a not so healthy lifestyle. So it's a big deal.
So I work at it as well. I lost, starting 6 years ago, I lost about 27 pounds. because I had gotten to the point where I stopped making it intentional. And then I got back on making it intentional, and about 6 years ago, I got it right. And I've stayed on that. But occasionally, I will cheat on my diet.
I cheat all the time. I don't have a diet.
You don't?
No. I don't have a diet. I mean, you sort of have the rhythm of, I bring my lunch to work. That's a big deal. You take your lunch to work, you save money, and you tend to eat the right things. You sit at a restaurant with a menu, and, you know, who has self-control at a restaurant?
Sure.
I don't. So, again, you just sort of build those disciplines in, but I don't have a specific diet.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Awesome. There's hope for the rest of us, though, right?
I don't drink soft drinks, but again, you know, but I can do some dessert, so.
Let's move on to personal finance. The data tells us that money, or better said, money management, or not good money,
lack
of money
management,
right? It has a major negative impact on relationships, which we're talking about here today, right? I heard a sermon, you shared a very simple idea about money, and that was that we should give first, save, and spend. Can you just tell us about that a bit?
Yeah, I call it the give, save, live principle. That you give first, you save second, live on the rest. Give first, save second, live on the rest. Give first. You don't even need to write it down. You don't even need to have a financial planner. You give first, save second, live on the rest. And I didn't learn it in these terms when I was a kid, but I grew up as a preacher's kid where we tithed. So sure. I would get 10 dimes, put, you know, one in the offering envelope, put one somewhere in a jar, and then do some whatever else I wanted to do with the other, you know, 7 dimes or 8 dimes. And so this became the habit of my life. Sandra was raised in a similar way. So from day one, whenever I'd get a paycheck, the first thing we would do is write a check. We would give to our church, but now we give to other organizations, and you don't have to give to a church. So you give first. And what that does, nobody wants to live on a budget. Most people don't have a budget. But I've recognized and experienced and have seen in the lives of so many people, if you will come up with a plan for giving first, you will come up with a plan for living second. You will develop a budget if giving is the first thing you do. Because when you decide to give first, it's a discipline and it's a sacrifice, and it makes you more cognizant of what you have and don't have. So give, save, live on the rest. And then the other best habit that we develop is we came up with a way from day one in our marriage to track where all our money was going. We tracked all of our spending. Everyone should be knowing where their money is going. If you don't know where your money's going, you can't cut back when you need to cut back. You can't save when you need to save. And in marriage, the reason people argue about money is because it seems to me that you, and it seems to her that I, and when it comes to money, there should never ever be any mystery, because we know exactly how much comes in. And we can, if we come up with a plan, know exactly where it's going. So money is the one area of life where there should be no mystery, because we know how much comes in and we have control over knowing where it goes.
Yeah, and all the systems that are set up in the financial industry today track it for you. Right?
Exactly. So it's easier than ever, but it's amazing. Couples will come in, they're going to set up a budget. I'm like, don't set up a budget. Live for 3 months or 6 months. Well, and keep track of where it's going. And then if you know where it's going, then you sort of have a budget and you can make minor adjustments. But to come up with an artificial budget and try to apply yourself to it, that rarely ever works. It's why most people don't live on a budget. So, you know, give, save, live.
For those of you that don't go to Andy's church, I have for over a long period of time, and Andy rarely ever asks for any money. And when he does, he usually asks for the money to go someplace else other than the church. And people will give money generously to the church because of the benefit they're getting back. But the point to you is just give somewhere, help somebody else make their life a little bit better.
And this ties into what we're going to talk about later in terms of relationships, because living open-handed is the best way to live. And the most practical way to start is with what is put in our hands monetarily. Again, we know how much it is. We know where it's going. So.
Yeah, when people get into money trouble, they usually think they don't make enough.
Right.
Instead of
they don't manage it well.
Right. Yeah. So fun and recreation. Mm-hmm. Okay. Those that know you pretty well know about music for you, mm-hmm. right? That you love music. So let's talk about that. I understand you still play some.
That's not true.
It's not?
No. I taught my daughter to play guitar and piano, and she's just graduated from college, and so that was the end of that. So I played in bands when I was younger. And then, honestly, it's an interesting story. I had a music studio. Sandra had we just had our third child. We had moved into a rental house. I was setting up my studio. I can hear little pitter-patter of feet upstairs, and Sandra's up there busy, and I realized this studio consumes so much of my time that I should be upstairs. And I put it all back in boxes, sold all of my equipment. That was the end of music for me. I mean, it was a big part of my life for a long time, but it was a season where it was just time for that to go. Awesome. And of course, I don't regret that decision one single bit.
Yeah, so that sacrifice about something that was really important to you, but it benefited something else much better, which is
my relationship.
Why you're still married and so well married, right? All right, what's your favorite all-time non-Christian rock song?
My favorite all-time song, I guess, is probably the song that introduced me to Elton John, I guess, back in eighth or ninth grade, Tiny Dancer from the Madman Across the Water album.
Wow.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
You all now have something about Andy that you know.
I'm
that
a huge Elton John fan.
Huge Elton John.
Yeah.
I grew up with Captain Fantastic, you know, when I was a kid.
Brown Tudor,
Cowboy. It was amazing. Yeah. It was great, 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 great. Mine is, we talked about this a few minutes ago.
Yeah,
Sweet Home Alabama.
I was going to say you
We're going to start wrestling
this.
Right now. Andy is an Auburn fan, by the way, for those that are out
because
there.
Because Jesus said, where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. And I sent so much of my treasure to the university, to Auburn, Alabama. That's where my heart
and
is.
And mine went to Tuscaloosa, so that's why we.
So you have misplaced treasure.
Do you pray that Auburn will beat Alabama?
I don't have to. I don't even have to pray. It just happens. It's amazing.
All right. I love it. All right. Let's move on to faith and community service. When did you know that you were being called to be a pastor?
Interesting story. So my dad's a Baptist pastor, and in the Baptist church, when college students or young people, as they called them, felt called to ministry, whatever that means, they would go down during the invitation, the altar call, tell the pastor would call the young men. It was always men back then, no women. You know, God, for some reason, God never called women back in the 70s. I don't know what happened. Baptist church would call the guys up and introduce them to the church and say, this is so-and-so, and he feels like God's calling him to ministry. So I had several friends who had that experience. So I was a freshman in college. I'm going somewhere with my dad in our green safari, 454 barrel, big old giant gas guzzler car. I just remember that. We're driving somewhere. And I loved the church, and I loved volunteering in the church. And at the time, I was actually had a part-time job while I was in college. And I said to my dad, I said, Dad, does a person have to be called into ministry? Can you just volunteer? That was my question. He'd just drive, and he said, I think you can volunteer. I said, well, I would like to volunteer for the ministry. And that was it. No lights, no angels, no voices, just it's what I wanted to do. And that's just what I started doing, and I've been doing it ever since.
Wow. Yeah. Pretty awesome. One other question, and then we're going to move on, right? So in faith and community service, who's your favorite biblical character and why?
Oh. Other than Jesus, I guess.
Yes, other than Jesus.
The Apostle Paul, who stepped onto the pages of history as someone who hated Christians and was intent on putting the church out of business because it felt like it was kind of a knockoff Jewish religion or cult. And on his way to Damascus, where he was going to arrest Christians and have Christians imprisoned and in some cases executed in the first century, he literally saw the light. In fact, that's where that phrase, I saw the light, came from. And the Apostle Paul became an avid church planter and gave us some of the richest, most fabulous literature to begin with. And he is an indisputable argument for the fact that Jesus rose from the dead. So I love what he wrote. I love how he lived his life. And he was executed in Nero's Rome. And I imagine the afternoon that they took him outside the city and beheaded him, he wondered, did anything I do matter? And did anything I wrote even make it out to the cities where...
Now he
knows
it did.
2,000 years later, we're still quoting him. Yeah, so.
Yeah, he didn't volunteer, by the way. He was called.
He was called, yes. He was definitely
That's
called.
For sure.
Yeah.
Last category, and then we're going to move on to today's topic of relationships. But this is about relationship, right? Because we're all getting to know each other a little bit now. So in business, I started at North Point 20 years ago. One building, maybe 1,500 people.
The church.
Thank you for reminding me to say the church.
They might have thought the mall. There's North Point mall. You've been to the mall.
Yes, I've been to the mall a few times. 20 years later, the growth that's taken place of that business would be the envy of any CEO. So what is one piece of advice you'd give me and to the folks that are watching today about how to build a great business?
It would be this. Everybody in your organization needs to be able to answer three questions. What are we doing? Why are we doing it? Where do I fit in? What are we doing? And everybody needs to be able to answer that question the same way. Why are we doing it? Everybody needs to be able to answer that question the same way. And number three, where do I fit in? And that's that personal responsibility description, not job description.
Sure.
Because we don't hire people to have jobs. We hire people to carry responsibility. So in our organization, I am adamant about as we hire people, as we grow, as we change the nature of what people are doing, everyone needs to have a statement that, you know, if all else fails, if you forget everything else, break the glass, pull this out. This is my personal responsibility description as it relates to what I'm doing here because of why we're doing what we're doing. And everybody should be able to answer those questions. And if you do, that impacts culture, it impacts focus, it impacts goal setting, it impacts where resources flow, it impacts everything. So that's kind of the leadership 101.
Yeah, you know, when we've met over the years, when I've left, I've often thought, I'm really glad you're not in my business competing against us. If you ever decided to get into our business.
I'm not going to get in your business.
Good, but if you did, listen, come here, I'll defer to you, yeah, right? No. I'll work for you anytime.
Yeah.
If you weren't doing what you're currently doing, what would you do?
People ask me that. I really don't know. I really don't think I could succeed in anything else. I mean, I like organizational life, but I don't know of a product that I would be super passionate about like I am what I'm doing. So I don't really know.
Cool. Let's move on with today's content for PMPB. The topic is relationships, and we want to get your insights and wisdom on two areas. Really, what are some of the key ingredients that help build the best long-term relationships at home and in the workplace? And certainly you have 30 years with Sandra, and you have 25 years at North Point, or 23 years with North Point, and maybe only one other job, right? So you've had long-term relationships on both sides. And then the second question that we'll hope you'll ask or answer is something that all of us have, which is broken relationships, and how can we think about healing those, and why should we, right? What are the benefits? So let's start with the first one. You know, what are the fundamental ingredients that go into building a great long-term relationship?
I think there's just one. And I'll illustrate it before as I share what it is. When our kids were coming along, we only had two rules in our home. Only two. And the two rules were honor your mother and tell the truth. That was it. That's only rules. And those two rules cover everything because of the one thing that drives healthy relationships, and that's the word honor. In a culture of honor, you don't have to have any rules because I instinctively know what is honoring to you and what is dishonoring to you. And I know instinctively when I'm placing myself ahead of you and in doing so dishonors you. And most people, most healthy people, most healthy adults understand that. They know when they're being dishonoring and they know when they're honoring. They know when they've been dishonored. Every single person watching or listening, they know when they have been dishonored. You may not use that terminology, but you feel it before you recognize it. So at the end of the day, it's about establishing cultures, whether it's at work or at home, where it's all about honor. We're foster parents, and our current foster daughter, she's 18, so she's aged out of the program, but she's still very much in our lives, and I texted with her yesterday, so we're her family forever, or we're willing to be when she'll have us, and she's mostly willing to have us. When she moved in with us, for those of you who foster or maybe came up through the foster care system, her family life before that was very chaotic. And so when she came in, she wanted to know the rules. And the reason she wanted to know the rules, we were the fourth foster home for her. And every foster home had all these rules. And then, because she was the master manipulator, and I would say that if she were sitting in the room, we laugh about it now.
Sure.
Why does she want to know the rules? Well, because if you'll give me the rules, I'll find the loopholes. Just give me about 10 minutes with your rules, and I'll find a way to never actually break a rule but dishonor you all along the way. And so I caught on to this pretty quick. And so I took a 3x5 card and I wrote the word honor and I handed it to her. And I said, this is how we do it here. We do not have rules. We just honor each other. And she wasn't really sure what to do with that. But that's the bottom line. And I know when I'm honoring you and I know when I'm dishonoring you. Now, as a Christian, this shouldn't come as a surprise because at the end of Jesus' ministry, right before he left and right before he was crucified, he gathered his guys together and he said, I'm just going to give you one rule, just one rule. They'd had 10 commandments. They'd had 613 commandments. He said, we're just going to, it's just one rule. I just want you to love each other the way I've loved you. That's it. Well, the way that I think that settles into family and to the marketplace is the word honor. If we use the word love, it gets kind of weird, you know. But honor, I understand, because honor says you first, me second. And I'll never do anything that dishonors you, and I expect you to show that honor to me. And when I dishonor you, the best way to honor you is to acknowledge I've dishonored you. So wherever that is the preeminent relational virtue or value, you just don't need a lot of rules.
Well, it says so much, because honor, I was sitting here listening to you, honor gets associated often with our armed forces, with military, right? And what's in that underneath honor is honorable discharge, right? Is that we've served, we've sacrificed, we've participated with others, we've done our own job, whatever that might be. We've complied and supported all of the hierarchy, whatever it is, parents or in this case, you know, kind of other military leaders. It's just, it's a great word, and I think it encompasses an awful lot. You know, the natural thing is not to honor someone else. The natural thing is to honor our own interests.
Absolutely. We all want to be recognized, and that is natural, but it's that pull. As long as you're trying to get honor and I'm trying to get the honor I deserve, there's going to be tension even before we've done anything. But if I can walk into my home or the marketplace or as an organizational leader, I mean, as organizational leaders, my job is to make sure everyone in the organization is treated with honor and gets the honor they deserve, not trying to pull it out of them or squeeze it out of them. And we've all seen or maybe worked for people who you felt like every single day they were trying to squeeze the honor out of you to get the honor they felt like they deserved. And nobody wants to work there. I mean, people will walk away from money in order to get into an environment that's characterized by honor. So, yep.
And honor may not be fair.
Honor is never fair. This is how I say it. Fairness, I'm a Christian, so fairness ended in the Garden of Eden. Nothing has been fair since the beginning, since the first sin entered the world.
Yeah.
So we don't shoot for fair. Fair is a fairy tale. We don't shoot for equal. It's not equal. I can't dunk a basketball. So nothing's equal. Nothing's fair. So once you take that out of the equation and quit trying to be fair and decide, you know what? What is the best way to honor this person's performance? What's the best way to honor this person's background? What's the best? And instinctively, everybody can figure that out. And when everybody's trying to figure that out, that's a happy place.
Well, I'll tell you what, that is really, really profound, because the one word, and that's the thing I'll tell you as a communicator that I've always just admired about you, I mean, it's what makes you who you are, is you can take the most complex issues like how to build great long-term relationships, and you could get it down to one simple idea that hopefully everybody will take with you. And, you know, I've told people in the past that you know, when someone is in our life and we really care for them, we say, we love you, and we'll say it a lot, right? The thing we need to say probably more, which is really honorable, is I'm sorry, because we'll all be flawed in our honoring of others, right? But when we are, there's a way to honor, which is to really own it and take responsibility instead of trying to figure out how to rationalize it. But you did a masterful job doing that. And I hope everybody today can take that with them and just think about that, whether it's in your marriage, whether it's within your relationship with significant others, with your children. You know, honoring your children is to appreciate and accept them just the way they are in terms of their gifting, because they're not all going to be, to the point that Andy can't dunk a basketball, the same. You got to dust it off just like we do here in the workplace and find their real God-given talent and honor that talent by admiring that talent rather than maybe one that they don't have. All right, the second place I wanted to take you today, because I think all of us in common, first of all, need to build great long-term relationships. We all struggle to do it, but thanks for the advice there. The second area is that we all have in common is that we've all had relationships in life where we've been hurt and where maybe there's brokenness there, and people have a way of dealing with that. Most people get bitter and they just leave that. And I don't ever think they get rid of it. They take it with them and others get less of them. But tell us, how do you go about thinking about you mending a broken relationship, and what are the benefits of doing it?
Well, it's two things. There's mending the broken relationship, and then there's doing the things that we need to do to get mended. Because sometimes you can't mend a broken relationship. If the other person doesn't want to play, no matter what you do, they don't want to have a relationship, and you can't if you force a relationship, it's not a relationship, right? So it begins with really mending on the inside, and the way that we do that is to forgive. Now, forgiveness is actually it's somewhat transactional, and in your business you'll understand this. Forgiveness is recognizing what I'm owed and then deciding you don't owe me anymore. That's what forgiveness is. Because if you've been hurt, that's something's been taken. Your first marriage was taken. Your relationship with your son was taken. Your reputation was taken. Your inheritance was taken. Your promotion was, something was taken. So we're angry. So recognizing what was taken, identifying that, which most people never do, they're just mad. They carry the emotion. They never stop to ask the question, okay, what specifically was taken from me? And sometimes you have to write it down. I recommend people write it down. Make a list. What was taken from me during those years? What was taken from me during that marriage? What was taken from me when I worked for her or worked for him? And then you have to decide, you know what? I am canceling this debt, because that's what creates the anger. You don't owe me anymore. I tell people sometimes they need a physical representation. They need to write it, put it, wad it up, put it in a trash bag, and walk it to the street and drop it in the trash can and say, I'm canceling this debt. You don't owe me. Now, that doesn't heal the relationship. That doesn't mend the relationship. That's how we mend our heart. And the reason this is so important, especially for those of you who are parents or grandparents, or maybe you've been out in a first marriage and you're in a second marriage and you're seeing some of the shrapnel from the first begin to affect the second. Forgiveness is giving someone what they do not deserve so that you can give the people in your life now what they do deserve. And until you choose to give the people from the past what they don't deserve, you won't have what you need to give the people in your life now what they do deserve. And this isn't a Christian thing. This is just a thing. This is just a people thing.
I mean, for all those that are out there today who don't believe what necessarily Andy and I believe, the bottom line is that if you're going to have a great relationship, long-term built relationship, or you're going to heal relationships, and we all need to heal them along the way in life for us to be best with the next relationship that we have, we're going to have to forgive. And so it transcends the whole Christian concept.
Oh, yeah.
It's just a part of being in relationship. You know, that was really impactful, because to the extent that people, they have all that energy in that debt that they feel is owed in the past.
And energy is the right word.
Yeah, the next person they come in contact with, they're a little bit less.
Yeah.
They're just less for that relationship, right? And wouldn't it be great if we were completely in the relationships that we're in today? And the only way we get there is by writing it down, putting in the garbage bag, and put it in the can.
My dad, who's 86 years old, he had a lot of resentment toward his stepfather. It's a long, difficult story. And so what he did, he literally, in his early 30s, put a chair in front of him and put his imaginary stepfather in that chair and just let him have it. I mean, it was just an empty chair.
But then it ended.
And then he sort of made his list, and then he canceled that debt. And for him, that was that physical exercise that allowed him because he had to end up taking care of his stepfather because he became an invalid and needed my dad's help. And my dad realized, you know what, I cannot be present for him if I've got this resentment toward him. And the other question we have to ask is, what story do I want to tell? Do I want to tell a story of, he hurt me when I was young, and then when I had an opportunity, I hurt him back? Is that the story we want to tell? Isn't the better story, he hurt me when I was young, I forgave him, and I did for him what he would not do for me? That's a better story. And all of us are in the process of writing our stories, and 90% of our stories are relational.
You know, we all have a story too, and we think it's so unique. Like, I was hurt this way, and mine is then therefore more important, and so I can't do what we're talking about doing. But the truth of the matter is that you go through life, you're going to wind up getting hurt, abandoned. You're going to get pain in relationship with important people that were in your life or are currently in your life. And I think the advice is just amazing, because we have to do something with that if we're going to wind up having our best life, which is what you want, what we want, what all of us want, right? So two things: building great long-term relationships, honor, right? And that word is really powerful because it covers so much ground. And then the second part of what we asked about today was, how do we heal relationships? And it doesn't mean that we're going to be back in the same relationship with that person, but it really is that we're going to wind up taking what we think that they owe us, and we're going to forgive that debt so we can move on and be our best in relationship with our kids, with our friends, with our family members, with the folks that we work with every single day. Of course, when we bring our best to the table, we're going to write our best life story, which is what it's all about. Andy, heartfelt thanks for taking your
Absolutely.
Time. I know how stretched it is, for sharing your wisdom with us today and being here. Whether you're building a great long-term relationship or healing a broken one, forgiveness will be a part of the recipe for success. And let me share a personal story as we close today that makes that point. I was born in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. My pops was the youngest of two. His only brother was a priest. My mom was the youngest as well, the youngest of 21. There were no priests in my mom's family. They met and married, and 6 years later, there were four boys. I was the third. We all fell sick with the chicken pox and all recovered, as expected, except the youngest, Larry. Larry passed away at three. I was four, Jim was six, and Tom was seven. My pop's heart was broken, and he sought healing through his faith. My mom's heart was broken too. She attempted to deal with her brokenness in a different way, like many do. She attempted to drink her pain away. Several years later, she left a note and she went away. The night she left, my pops took me, Jim, and Tom to Jackie Gleason's restaurant in Miami. Worst cheeseburger I ever had. Mom was gone and the cheese was blue. That evening, my pops planted seeds in his boys' lives that changed our lives forever, and ultimately my mom's as well. He said, "Forgive your mom. She's the only mom you'll ever have." He was 30. He lost a son and now his wife, and now he's on his own raising three boys. He said, "Forgive her," and his actions followed his words. I can't imagine how different my life and my brother's lives and all who have experienced us since would be had my dad made a different choice that night. He cooked, he cleaned, he coached us, he introduced us to community service, and he built a tremendous career in banking. His cooking and cleaning were suspect. His coaching left his boys better, and he made the world a better place as a result of it. His actions also earned him a nickname for a patriarch like none other I've ever heard, the Source. We maintained relations with our mom throughout our teenage years. When our career started, we all made sure mom was cared for financially. And then one day, I reread the Ten Commandments. Number five, honor thy father and thy mother, and it will go well with you. By the way, there are no footnotes to this command. That day, we moved from maintaining to honoring my mom. We told mom that no matter what choices were made in the past, we simply wanted her to be our mom again. That's forgiveness. Her last 7 years were her best 7 years. She passed away 10 years ago, and we have zero regrets because we followed my pop's instructions and we forgave my mom. He taught us at that time life's most important relationship lesson. And if relationships are the most important part of life, he taught us life's most important lesson. I hope and pray every one of us in attendance today forgives one person, heals one relationship, because if we do, we'll make the world a better place. Andy, again, thanks so much for taking the time, for sharing your wisdom with all of us here today. If all of you want to keep up with Andy, and I strongly recommend you do, you can check him out at North Point Online, follow him on Twitter at Andy Stanley, and pick up his new book, Irresistible, coming out September 18th.